Today on Typical Books, we're going to be talking about The Haunting of Velkwood by Gwendolyn Kiste. I had a great time with this book, and this review has been a bit of a long time coming because I mentioned it quite a while ago that I wanted to review this on the show. So yeah, what drew me to reading The Haunting of Velkwood by Gwendolyn Kiste? Before I get really into it, I will say that Jason from Jason's Weird Reads, Jason White, talked to Gwendolyn on his show. So if you want to see a really great interview, tune in there. Now, The Haunting of Velkwood is a 2024 book put out by Saga Press, which is an imprint of Simon & Schuster. I chose this book entirely based on the summary. Now, it did not hurt that it was written by a three-time Bram Stoker Award winner, and it had a very cool cover. Now, while I'm not a big fan of yellow, I did appreciate how it looked like police tape sort of feel without actually being police tape. You get a sense of being barred from seeing what the picture is on account of this bright yellow text. Or it's like a warm, weird mustard yellow, or the yellow of lines painted down the middle of a road, but the actual road is not quite there. After reading the novel, the cover takes on a slightly deeper meaning, only a little slightly deeper, but it certainly caught my eye and it played really well with the summary. While writing style doesn't really ever influence my choice of a book, I really do like a strong sense of narrative. I'm not very character driven, and that's what this is. It's written in the first person. It's a first person present tense, so nothing overly experimental or jarring. I just find the first person really works if you want to take someone on a journey, and that's exactly what this book does when we go back to Velkwood. It's kind of a hometown haunt like no other. I can't really think of a read-alike for this book, and that's a good thing. It's no wonder that I wanted to read it straight over again as soon as I was finished, because there's nothing to really follow it up with. It's a mood all entirely of its own, and I kind of didn't want to leave that place. So from the back cover, the Velkwood vicinity was the topic of occult theorists, tabloid one-hour documentaries, and even some pseudo-scientific investigations as the block of homes disappeared behind a near impenetrable veil that only three survivors could ever enter, and only one has in the past 20 years, until now. Talitha Velkwood has avoided anything to do with the tragedy that took her mother and 8-year-old sister, drifting from one job to another, never settling anywhere or with anyone, feeling as trapped by her past as if she were still there in the small town she so desperately wanted to escape from. When a new researcher tracks her down and offers to pay her to come back to enter the vicinity, Talitha claims she's doing it for the money. Of all the crackpot theories over the years, no one has discovered what happened the night that Talitha, her estranged former best friend Brett, and Grace escaped their homes 20 years ago. Will she finally get the answers that she's been looking for all these years, or is it just another dead end? It's a really well-written summary for a really well-written book. The story begins with our main character on her front porch being propositioned by this paranormal researcher, and it carries on this plot of not wanting to return to her haunted hometown, which is a street named after the Velkwood family, named after her. Maybe they just lived on the street for so long that it was called simply Velkwood, and it once technically had like a street or a lane or an avenue or something, like my childhood avenue. That everyone just calls by its first name. And the paranormal researcher, after he leaves, Talitha gets on the phone with Brett, another survivor, and we get the gist very quickly that they are indeed survivors. To talk about this paranormal researcher who they call Jack the Cute One, that's about the most friendly conversation they have. Right off the bat, we understand that there is a genuine sense of hesitation, fear, and anxiety in their conversation that's related to going home. And unlike small town horror novels, we don't get any explanation right away. We don't get like half the story of why they don't want to go home, really. We just get that she does not want to go and Brett doesn't think she should. Our explanations come in fits and starts throughout the book as Talitha does inevitably return to Velkwood. Something terrible happened there, obviously, and something terrible is continuing to happen 20 years later. So the setting is this street, Velkwood. It reminds me of so many other small cul-de-sac neighborhoods, even actual haunted anomalistic ones, mostly in Pennsylvania. Lincoln Way in Clareton used to be a very similar sounding street to Velkwood. For a decade, it was the favorite of urban explorers and ghost hunters until it was torn down entirely. The entire town of Centralia suffered a similar fate with no paranormal leanings to that particular story. If you're a fan of the Silent Hill franchise, you may be familiar with Centralia, Pennsylvania. Both are actual real life abandoned neighborhoods or towns in the case of Centralia. And there are larger ones across the entire country, and mostly by the country, I mean the United States. We have a lot of abandoned places here in Canada, a lot of more depressed areas, and you could count entire places like Flint, Michigan as mostly abandoned, and a lot of places after Hurricane Katrina became abandoned. But this is a particular type of abandonment that we're talking about. And in most cases, it's toxic ground in real life. But here we're dealing with the paranormal. So I believe Velkwood would be in either Ohio or Pennsylvania, both of which the author has called home. The setting reminds me very much of a cookie cutter prefabricated areas where all the houses sort of look the same. But then in amongst all that, you find that one original road where the houses have been lived in by the same families for maybe two generations or more. And the houses aren't exactly like all those prefab mid-2000s monstrosities because they're a little older. And it's because that street is from before. And that's what Velkwood reminds me of. It's one of those little cul-de-sacs that lives in this liminal space between all the big subdivisions and comes from a time when there used to be a little breathing room in the suburbs. Now those forgotten little corners, little cul-de-sacs, little lanes and little ways between the larger, more densely packed suburbia. Richard Florida would be so proud. There's a looming sense of nostalgia without being spoon-fed. Nostalgia can be nauseating when it's part of this kind of wave of 80s nostalgia. And this is like the 80s, 90s stories told by someone who really lived through the time. And it's told not only in pop culture and media hits of the 80s, but it's told in how to create the hairstyles, the actual tools used in day-to-day life, the fabrics and the clothing and what was worn and the state of things that you use to identify yourself and where you fit in that world. It's those subtle hints of nostalgia that were so much more interesting to me than the wave of 80s pop culture that has rolled back lately. And what's on the floor of a teenage girl's bedroom in the 80s? No mass media entertainment vehicle can really describe that the way that this book did. And it did that without seeming to try. It seemed like an accidental nostalgic trip just because of the place where part of the story takes place. Now, just the simple setup of the area itself, almost encased in a bubble of paranormal activity with a dozen researchers hovering around, it gives you this feeling like the house in E.T. when the researchers descend. It's a terrifying horror moment in that film, and we live that for decades within The Haunting of Velkwood. That little tiny 3-minute part of E.T. that terrified me as a kid is what this entire book is. And on top of that, we have a love story. Not a typical love story, so it works really well if you're not a romance fan. But the romance that exists here is really relatable, whether or not you've been in these situations. This isn't something that I could literally relate to, but I think that it's something that everyone can on some level of exploring adolescent love, the influence of others, and what they influence they have on that, being denied freedom at a young age, much more than just being about the one that got away. This touches on societal expectations, posing actual barriers, and ruining any chance you have at happiness. Now that is what the white picket fence on a friendly cul-de-sac represents to a lot of people, oppression. And this kind of side-eyes that feeling from start to finish. Now for the characters, Talitha Velkwood is our main character and the survivor of Velkwood incident. And that's what we basically call it, I believe, throughout the book. It's the Velkwood vicinity and the Velkwood incident. And I'll call it that. So I don't want to spoil really a thing. So we're not going to touch on who's dead, who's alive, who's a ghost, and if they are ghosts at all and all that stuff. Because you'll really need to read the book to appreciate all of that. And there are dead people. So you know they play a real part in this story, whether or not we're introduced to them off the hop or their state of being. It becomes very apparent who is and who is not when you're reading it, and what side they're on the line of the sand that divides Velkwood in the history and Velkwood, the incident and Velkwood vicinity, which is the paranormal haunting, for lack of a better term. There are broad brushstrokes describing Talitha, her character, and I like that in a main character, where you can not exactly impress yourself upon them or more easily live vicariously through them, but you can more easily understand what they're going through because so much of it is left for you to make up in your imagination based on your lived experience. What we made of Talitha is an exhausted and terrified individual, and we've all been there to some extent once or twice in our lives. So Sophie Velkwood is Talitha's younger sister and an adorable little younger sibling. That's really all she is. We don't see a lot of her. She reminds me of one of those typical little sibling kids in a horror anime series that is always kind of whiny, kind of clingy, and just really adorable. It really works to impress upon the reader that someone so little and so innocent shouldn't be involved in something so terrifying and adult as the tragedy that is Velkwood. Brett is Talitha's best friend, or was Talitha's best friend. It's really hard to draw a line with these two. The story progresses with them kind of rekindling a friendship of some sort, accidentally or reluctantly, with coming back to Velkwood because the paranormal researcher's interest in the Velkwood vicinity has involved both of them. The researchers contacted Brett before, but she had denied to go, so when Talitha does, she decides she might just have to pay a visit. Grace and Del are a girlfriend and boyfriend, and this is a friend group, right? So you have Sophie and Brett, and Grace and Enid. Del is the boyfriend of Grace and kind of on the periphery. Not a very interesting character, really, honestly. And there's brothers and there's other people on the street and there's neighbors. Their stories kind of unfold a little bit as we get to know the Velkwood vicinity. They're all involved in the Velkwood incident, but Grace's reaction to it all is kind of off the wall. So Grace in particular, who cares about Del? It's about Grace. Her reaction offers a contrast to all of her other friends. We have this strong one, the thoughtful one, the one who leaves, and then we have Grace, the reactionary. She's also had dealings with these paranormal researchers. For all of Enid that I recall, let's call her the thoughtful one. If I recall correctly, she's fair-haired, pale skin, and just kind of wallflower pretty. The one that is actually also kind of weird. She has the weird streak. We don't, again, spend a lot of time with Enid, but when you really think about it, their friend group kind of starts and stops with her. I'll leave that too when you read the book. Then we have Jack, the cute one, as they call him. I don't believe Jack has a last name, but he's the head of the paranormal research group that is living around the Velkwood vicinity. Now, if you can imagine a street that is abandoned, that has a paranormal presence, which ended in a large national news incident at one point, and now no one really dares go in it, or can't go in it, or may not return from it. No one really knows. That's just not somewhere you want to live. So there's no proof that it's not safe yet, but it's taken 20 years of people being uncomfortable living around Velkwood, and a lot of the surrounding houses are abandoned. So the researchers just live in them, it seems. I think they've bought up some areas of it, or they're squatting. It's hard to tell. The Velkwood vicinity is a character of its own. Not a character in a Stephen King haunted house sort of way, where the house itself breathes and lives and moves kind of like a creature. It does have these symbiotic creatures in the faceless, nameless researchers that cling to its sides. A giant beached whale, this vicinity is, with things feeding off of it, and feels kind of like these researchers in the vicinity are all one. They're sort of some sort of anomaly in and of themselves and together, and I really think that it's a brilliant move where you want to breathe life into a setting. What better way to do it but than to have the residents around embody that personality as well? It's really hard to distinguish where the sort of ravenous, paranormal, unexplainable, voiceless, faceless entity begins and ends. And is it the surrounding people? Is it the surrounding people? Was it always the people? Is it the vicinity itself and the very ground? Really impossible to discern, and a wonderful journey trying to indirectly answer those questions. So the moment I finished reading The Haunting of Velkwood, I wanted to just start it over again and read it again immediately. Several weeks later, I still feel that way, and I don't want to read a book like it. I want to read this book. As noted previously, I can't think of any read-alikes that go along with this, but it is a small town horror. It's got that basic premise that something has happened in your small town and you need to return and you don't want to. And I love that feeling so much. Every small town horror basically begins and ends like that, and you go back and it's terrible results. I've read some really great small town horror recently, like Ronald Malby's Small Town Horror and Withered and Grey Dog. All the tiny town areas, or maybe rural areas, and one even dips into folk horror. This one, not so much. Velkwood is a contemporary and modern paranormal story. The closest thing in tone would probably be Devil's Creek by Todd Kiesling, another I don't want to return home story. Also another Pennsylvania-based author. Now, those who have read this book that I've heard talk about it feel the same way. It's an impeccable book, a deep book, a quick read, though. Not too heavy, not overwritten in the slightest. So if you're a big fan of small town horror and paranormal research and fiction, I highly recommend The Haunting of Velkwood, and I hope that you enjoy it as much as I did. Did you read this Gwendolyn Kiste book? Are you a fan of her books otherwise? I've not read other ones. The Rust Maidens was kind of on my list. There's others that catch my eye, so I don't know. I should read some more. I've read her short fiction here and there and listened to her talk about writing on different podcasts and BookTube shows and in real life. So I really do enjoy her as an author. I just need to read more of her stuff. So if you have anything to recommend, let me know in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching, and have an ookie spooky day.